my name is Dr. Marie-Christelle Ross. I'm a cardiologist based in Lévis in Quebec, Canada. I'm a sports cardiologist and I do a lot of high altitude medicine as well as diving in hyperbaric medicine. So today we're just going to touch upon the cardiovascular implications of diving, and mainly we're going to focus on the hyperbaric chamber. So the literature is fairly scarce on the heart relating to diving or hyperbaric. We know from the diving physiology that any underlying cardiac condition could potentially be catastrophic in the water. What we know is that when you're standing in the water, there's hydrostatic pressure on your veins, and that increases the venous return to the heart by up to 700 milliliters, which is very clinically significant. If you've got a structurally normal heart, you can accommodate that. However, if you have underlying heart failure or even severe coronary artery disease, then it could pose a problem. As well, what we have to keep in mind when we evaluate a diver from a cardiovascular point of view is that you cannot control the environment. So you can be in cold water, there could be a lot of current. So theoretically, you may end up doing something that you were not planning on doing, and your energy expenditure could be a lot higher, therefore predisposing you to having a cardiac complication. On the other hand, when we're talking about the chamber, it's an environment that we can control and it's dry. So those factors, the water temperature, the current, you don't have to take that into account when assessing a patient who's going to undergo hyperbaric oxygen therapy. In the chamber, mainly what we see, as opposed to like in diving, I've mentioned there's a significant increase in the venous return, but in the hyperbaric chamber, we don't see that. There's not, even if we compress the air or the oxygen, the density is not sufficient to really compress the blood vessel or the veins. So there's no significant increase in venous return. However, we see a significant increase in the periphery vascular resistance by up to 25%. And that can have a significant impact in someone already having a cardiac condition underneath. We also see a significant bradycardia. The heart rate can decrease by up to 6 to 10 beats under hyperbaric condition. And coupled with that, we know that the cardiac output is a function of the heart rate and the stroke volume. So on one hand, we decrease the heart rate, and on the other hand, the stroke volume doesn't increase because we don't have that increase in the venous return. And there's even some papers suggesting a slight decrease in the cardiac contractility. So all of that put together, we tend to see a slight decrease in the cardiac output. So one of the things that we fear in the chamber is pulmonary edema. The incident overall is very low. However, that being said, we don't have many papers looking at the incidents per se. What we have in the literature is more like case reports, mainly of patients with ejection fraction below 40% who were undertaking HBOT for various reasons and who developed shortness of breath and confirmed pulmonary edema within the chamber. The explications for that, it's probably multifactorial for sure. The increase in vascular resistance definitely contributes, as well as probably a slight decrease in the cardiac output. And if you have someone who has a healthy heart, they're going to be able to take that without problems. But if you have someone with heart failure, especially if the ejection fraction is below 40%, all of a sudden I would be a lot more concerned about those patients. And you really have to weigh the risks and the benefits of putting someone in the chamber if their ejection fraction is below 40%. But in general, it is well tolerated, and at least you can control the environment as opposed to diving, where there's a lot of things that could happen and that were not necessarily planned.